Today we gather to celebrate the life of Shirley Marshall. Her full name was Shirley Elizabeth Pat Marshall, as many of you know. And she was a beloved member of this congregation. I am Reverend Janet Stoddard, the pastor here at Elmwood Community Church, for just a short time, so I only got to meet Shirley once. But it was a wonderful time that we had together, and I'm grateful and will always be grateful for the opportunity to meet her. So it's my great privilege to be here with you all today. We gather to tell stories, some funny, some sad, but all those details that made up a life well lived. Even though Shirley had a long life, there is sadness today because she will be greatly missed by her children and their families and her church family. She was an important part of this community of faith for 66 years, and she will certainly be missed by this church. There is a sacredness in tears. They are not a mark of weakness, but of power. They speak more eloquently than 10,000 tongues. They are messengers of overwhelming grief and unspeakable love. Shirley was and is indeed loved, and it is that love that we come together to celebrate today. Friends, we gather here in the protective shelter of God's healing love. We are free to pour out our grief, release our anger, face our emptiness, and know that others share our grief and care about our sadness. We gather here conscious of others who have died and of the frailty of our own existence here on earth. We come to comfort and support one another in our common loss. We gather to offer thanksgiving for the life of Shirley Marshall. I was going to say her whole name again, but I've said it. So. Let us pray. Oh God, you have ordered this wonderful world and know all things in earth and in heaven. Give us such faith that by day and by night, at all times and in all places, we may without fear commit ourselves and those dear to us to your never-failing love in this life and in the life to come. Amen. Just a couple of announcements before the first hymn. We're wearing masks. The mask mandate in West Hartford is lifted, but the family has requested that we wear masks, and there's some in the back if you don't have one. And when people talk up front, we won't be wearing masks because it's difficult to hear, even if you can hear well. The other announcement is that we won't be singing. You can hum, and have one more announcement at the end of the service. That's all the announcements. Did I forget it?
The basket.
Oh, the reflections. There's a piece of paper that you all got, and if you want to leave a reflection of Shirley in the basket, either here or on the table in the back or on the table on the side, if you don't want to walk up the stairs, feel free to do so, and we'll collect them, and the family will have those for their reflection and looking at them later. Okay, let us hum together or join together in continuing with the worship service with a song that Shirley, a hymn that Shirley liked, Abide With Me.
Thank you.
turn to Scripture for comfort and to guide us in the world. The first scripture is from Psalm 23, and if you want to speak into your mass, you can join me or mumble this familiar passage. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The next passage is from Romans 8, the last selected verses from the end of Romans 8. And I read this because I believe truly that nothing separates us from the love of God, but also that nothing can separate us from the love we have for those who are dearest to us in our lives. And Shirley was indeed a dear and loving woman. And I think that love that she had for everyone here and the love that those of you who knew her best had for her will continue to go on, and that death does not kill that love. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit. Because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God, we know that all things work together for good for those who love God. For those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those who he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his Son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who is to condemn? Is it Christ Jesus who died? Yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And the last reading is from John 14, 1 through 3. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. Here ends the readings of God's holy word. Thank you. celebration, Kate Thompson Marshall will read John's remembrances of his mom, Shirley.
Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming to pay your respects and to celebrate the life of Shirley Marshall. Sweet, adorable, lovely, a wonderful lady. Those are just few of the words that anyone who knew Shirley would use to describe her. Shirley was one of a kind. She had a rocky beginning. Her birth mother died when she was very young. She battled tuberculosis, and her father remarried. And although her stepmother was a nurse, nurturing was not her strong suit. As all kids will, Shirley would defy the nurse's wishes and take the bus to her mother's family's house to visit. Hence her spark, her allegiance to those who took care of her. This challenging childhood made her who she was, independent, fierce, and kind. She was loyal, trusting, compassionate, and sweet all the time. Shirley was never judgmental, and she appreciated all gestures, big and small. We all spent a great deal of time together, and she enjoyed all the antics of our family. Everyone flocked to her, and many fought over who got to pick her up for the holidays. Shirley was the touchstone, the consummate lady, an absolute doll. We all look forward to spending time with her, hearing her stories, and witnessing her never-ending optimism. People wanted to take care of her and protect her. This included our dog Jackson, who bit the mailman who got too close to his Grammy. Upon hearing of Shirley's passing, many have reached out and sent their condolences, as well as their appreciation for how lucky they were to have met her. No one ever forgot meeting her, and everyone loved her charm, her wit, and her candor. The last time we spoke, she asked me if the boat was out of the water. And I told her, it just came out on Monday. She paused and said, So boating season is officially over. We took this as a metaphor. A great part of our lives was now over. You are a sweetheart, Cheryl. Our hearts are broken, but we were blessed to have you all these years. You had many great words of wisdom, some of which were, and I hope I get this right, only God's chosen few get to pass in their sleep. Shirley, you were certainly one of God's chosen few, and we miss you already.
Kate and I get the honors of reading the comments of John and Beth, assuming that we can make it through better than them. I remember doing this 10 years ago for Al, and I'm not sure I made it through, so. Not starting out well.
There's Kleenex underneath the meal. There's Kleenex.
So these are Beth's words. As I sip my tea, wiping tears and composing reflections of my dear mother, I think about some of the things we had in common. We are both mothers, both daughters, both lovers of a nice cup of tea and nature, the beach, history, and we're both makers of yarn. I spin yarns out of fibers, whereas Mom's yarns were created from stories, experiences, and chats with friends, usually over a cup of tea. Her yarns were made of truth, not fiction, although we can't be sure they weren't slightly embellished over her 97 years. If you were ever lucky enough to have a cup of tea with Mom, you'll know it was a thing, a special time for talking, sharing, and connecting. It was also the time when she did her best listening. Stories told are stories remembered. I'd like to remember Mom through her stories, the moments of yarn making, mothering, and tea drinking. Back in high school, after a long walk home from classes, my friends and I would sit in the kitchen and have a cup of tea with Shirley, where we would process the day, and Mom would listen and let us vent. She would laugh at our jokes, show compassion for our adolescent pain, provide empathy when needed, and just be with us. During this special and memorable time, she was like a mother to all of us. Recently, one of my friends said to me, "I always wish Shirley could have been my mom." This is something that I have heard from others over the years. I am sure Mom would have accepted another child with an open heart. I feel deeply blessed to have been given Shirley as my mother. She was the best mother inside and out. The way Mom became the mother she was speaks of her inner strength and being born with a heart of gold, because her own experience of being mothered was fraught with many challenges and losses. Her beloved mother died of tuberculosis when Shirley was just 4 years old. In order for her father to continue to support them, she had to go live with her overly strict grandmother, where her few joyful moments were when her kind and soft-spoken grandfather took her for ice cream in the park with Laddie Boy, her favorite stuffed animal. I'm guessing this is when her love for ice cream began. In 1930, there were no cures or immunizations for TB. It was highly contagious, with entire families getting ill. Her grandfather became sick also, and it was around that time that Shirley was placed in a TB sanatorium where she spent the next year of her now motherless life. I just can't imagine how traumatizing that might have been for a small child, watching her mother get so sick and die, then her grandfather getting sick, moving twice, and living away from her loving father in a cold institution. And cold it was, both literally and figuratively. Mom often related the story about how all the children in the ward would play outside in the dead of winter wearing nothing but their underclothes. I Googled it and it's true. This was a state-of-the-art treatment for tuberculosis back then. It must have worked because she was eventually discharged and went home to her father's house and a brand new and difficult stepmother. When I reflect on the story of my mother's life and her scarce experiences of being lovingly mothered, I wonder how she could possibly end up being the tender, loving, kind, and awesome mother she was. Was it because she endured so many hardships in her life and understood what it was like to be motherless, both metaphorically and literally? Was it because she knew death well? How did she turn out so good? The mother we all needed. The mother we wanted to have, in many ways, the mother of all. There is an important component on a spinning wheel, a simple piece of wood that holds together all the essential elements that enable the wheel to function, called the mother of all. It houses the bobbin that collects the spun yarn, it holds the whirls that adjust the speed, and the cords that keep the tension just right. When I'm at my spinning wheel, I think, this is just like my mother. She is the mother of all in so many ways. She keeps the tension around her under control, which in turn allows creativity or simplicity in the art of the yarn. She keeps the wheel in motion and is able to make fine adjustments if things get tangled, helping to move things along if they get stuck. Shirley is not the only mother I ever had, but she's the only one who let me through the door of her heart. The one who mothered me, the one I called Mom. She came into my life when I needed her most and remained for as long as she could. She picked me up when I came undone. She guided me through the trials and tangles of life. She gave me the encouragement and the voice to sing my own song, create my unique yarn. She always knew just the right thing to say. She knew how to coax the wheel to spin again when things went wrong. But most important, as mother of all, she knew about love. She was love in abundance. She gave love and graciously received love. Her love really had no bounds. She had a way of making you feel important and listened to, mothered, and nurtured. I will really miss those special moments with Mom over a cup of tea, the yarns shared of her notable ancestors, her friends, her life, and the things she did, and I will miss her benevolent soul. In the first few days after she died, there was a giant hole in my heart and a fear that she was no longer with me, that I had truly lost her. I longed for a sign that she could still hear me and I her, that I could share a small story or tell her something that happened. I was drowning in tears and looking to the heavens when suddenly the clouds parted, revealing a bright blue, sun-graced sky. I knew then she was there, still mothering, still radiating her light on all of us, sending us faith and courage, still lifting us up and helping us to see the sunlight, and casting her loving glow over us all. Her web of connection is strong and will carry her stories through time, always remembering her. With every cup of tea, I will think of my mom, for I know she is watching from the other side, creating new yarns and having a nice cup of tea in God's kitchen.
Thank you, Kate and Barry, for sharing the words of John and Beth. I was fortunate to have a cup of tea with Shirley. And the former pastor, David, I heard went over often, and because of COVID and restrictions, I've only had a cup of tea with Shirley, but I share her love of tea, her love of the song Edelweiss, her love of ice cream. And nothing I could say would compare to those words that her children have spoken through their loved ones today. But I do have to add that another component of Shirley that, and it's why we're here today, is she and her husband had a very strong faith. And that seemed to be at the core of everything she did, whether it was a nightly phone call to her friend or sharing her ability to be a good mother with somebody who had lost their mom, or her love of this church, or any of the million things she did throughout her lifetime. Her faith gave her a sense of resilience that most people wouldn't have, having lived through what she did as a child, and persevered through her life with her stepmother. But she adored her dad, and she adored her family, and she adored this church, and she adored her husband, who her friend said is they're now having lunch together. So, we can celebrate her life, her faith, her love of tea, which I'll think of her when I have tea. The story of the tea I told to Beth earlier, but I went over and she said, oh, I'll make a cup of tea. And she went to put the tea in the microwave, which, sorry, but it's a sin against tea. And I said, can I make tea with your kettle? She had an electric kettle, which if you've lived in England, which I have, you have to have an electric kettle. Once you have one, you can't go back. And so she said, okay. She wasn't very happy that just meeting her was going to make her tea, but I persevered because kind of like that, and I made tea, and we sat down to drink the tea, and she took her first sip, and she said, wow, that's hot, because microwave tea is not just the same. So we enjoyed a long conversation over tea, and I will treasure that time that I got to know her, and I was very impressed, and I will always be impressed that at 97, she was still going up and down the stairs, she was living alone, she did have help, but she was really a spitfire, and she really was an amazing woman, and that legacy will live on through her children, but especially through her grandchildren, and all those who celebrate her spiritual legacy and her life, and am sure she is celebrating with God today. Let us pray. O God, our strength and our Redeemer, giver of life and conqueror of death, we praise you with humble hearts, with faith in your great mercy and wisdom, and we entrust surely to your eternal care. We praise you for your steadfast love for her all the days of her life, and we thank you that she didn't have to suffer long, that she, for her and for her family, all her sickness and sorrow are ended, and death itself is past, and she has entered the home where all your people gather in peace. Keep us all in communion with your faithful people in every time and place, that at the last we may rejoice together in the heavenly family where Jesus Christ reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And let us join in saying the Lord's Prayer using trespasses. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we have a special treat. Beth is going to play Amazing Grace on the bagpipes. And while she's setting up, I want to remind you that all of you are invited to reception following the service at Rockledge Country Club, very close by, 289 South Main Street, West Hartford. Maps are available in the back if you have any questions. It's about 5 minutes from here.
To say whether or not the bass drone goes, we'll know what's happening.
Don't forget to read.